One viewer had asked why in my readings I refer to the tree of life and the spheres and all of that. She had never heard of that before, and that's something you might not ordinarily encounter. Now, to begin to explain what I mean, I have to take you all the way back to the earliest myths and writings of humans with the tree of life. And it's funny because it's one of the most pervasive and enduring legends in the history of religion. It was a real tree that grew on the planet millenniums ago. Its history is pan-cultural. Belief in its reality spans from deep within the Stone Age to the present. It has always been associated with divinity and immortality, and it was the Axis Mundi, otherwise known as the World Tree, to the cultures of that time. This is more than a story of a tree. It is of a movement of people, language, and cultures, and how we came to be. Through all the twists and turns, ebbs and flows, this is our forgotten history, and it starts a long, long time ago. And not that far, far away. The Tree of Life is a widespread myth or archetype of the world's mythologies, related to the concept of sacred tree more generally, and hence in religious and philosophical tradition, can be found all over the world, including the prehistoric Americas, many of which include a serpentine creature in their stories, which date back to man's earliest writings, as I said, like in the Sumerian tale of Gilgamesh, who had broken a branch off of the Tree of Life, and anyone that consumed it would have immortality. While the gods sent a snake to steal it from him because they didn't think any human deserved immortality. And the snake ended up eating it. And so Gilgamesh was deprived of immortality. And the gods forced the snake to crawl on its belly, which sounds a little bit similar to the biblical version. Except they weren't eating a branch off the tree, they were eating the fruit of the tree. A serpent was encouraging it, not trying to take it back. And in the biblical tradition, like in the Sumerian tale, God condemns the snake to crawl forevermore on its belly, and he throws man, Adam and Eve, out of the Garden of Eden, which is a type of immortality. Furthermore, this serpentine creature continues on in China with Taoism. They had a dragon that sat at the roots of the tree. Viking traditions had a giant water serpent at its base. And even here in the Americas, the Mayans had an alligator-like caiman at its trunk. Now, the Tree of Knowledge, connecting to heaven and the underworld, and the Tree of Life, connecting all forms of creation, are both forms of the World Tree, or Cosmic Tree, and are portrayed in various religions and philosophies as the same tree. Various trees of life are recounted in folklore, culture, and fiction, often related to immortality or fertility. They had their origin in religious symbolism. You know how I talked about Gilgamesh? I guess it's somewhat through that story I'm going to tie in the cards, because the Babylonians conquered the Sumerians and kind of took over their culture and their beliefs, including the story of Gilgamesh. And then the Assyrians came in and they conquered Babylon and to took over, you know, a lot of their culture. And it's the Assyrians who seem to have first made the diagram of the Tree of Life, or a diagram. There's many different types, but this is passed down. And now this diagram of the Tree of Life normally consists of 10 nodes symbolizing different archetypes and 22 lines connecting the nodes. The nodes are often arranged into three columns to represent that they belong to a common category. The nodes are usually represented as spheres, and the lines are usually represented as paths. The nodes usually represent encompassing aspects of existence, God, or the human psyche. The lines normally represent the relationship between the concept ascribed to the spheres, or symbolic description of the requirements to go from one sphere to another. The nodes are also associated to deities, angels, celestial bodies, values, colors, or a combination of them, and specific numbers. The columns are usually symbolized as pillars. These pillars usually represent different types of values, electric charges, or types of ceremonial magic. It's usually referred to as the Kabbalistic Tree of Life in order to distinguish it from other concepts with the same name. In the Jewish Kabbalah, the nodes are called Sephiroth. The diagram is also used by Christian Kabbalah, Hermetic Kabbalah, and Theosophy. Scholars believe that the concept of a Tree of Life with different spheres representing encompassing aspects of reality traces its origins back to Assyria, like I said, in the 9th century BC, where they also assigned values and specific numbers to their deities, similar to those used by the later Jewish Kabbalah. The beginnings of the Jewish Kabbalah are traced back by scholars to the medieval age, originating in the Book of Behir and the Book of Zohar. However, the first historic instance of the modern diagram appeared centuries later in the Latin translation of Gates of Light in the year 1516. The version used by modern Jewish Kabbalists first appeared in 1591. And Kabbalists believed the Tree of Life to be a diagrammatic representation of the process by which the universe came into being. They also don't envision time and space as pre-existing and place them at the next three stages on the Tree of Life. Numbers are very important to Kabbalists, and the Hebrew letters of the alphabet also have a numerical value for the Kabbalists. Each stage of the emanation of the universe on a Tree of Life is numbered meaningfully from 1 to 10. Each number is thought to express the nature of its sphere. The first three spheres, called the supernal spheres, are considered to be the primordial energies of the universe. The next three stages of evolution on the Tree of Life are considered to exist beyond a space on the tree, called the abyss. Between the supernals and the other spheres, because of their level of being, are so distinct from each other that they appear to exist in two totally different realities. The supernal spheres exist on a plane of divine energy. This is why another correspondence for B'nai is the idea of suffering, because the supernal maternal energy gives birth to a world that is inherently excluded from that divine union. After B'nai, the universe gets down to the business of building the materials it will need to fulfill its evolution and be creating new combinations of those materials until it is so dense that by the stage of Malkuth, the initial pure limitless energy has solidified into the physical universe. Since its energies are the basis of all creation, the Tree of Life can potentially be applied to any area of life, especially the inner world of man, from the subconscious all the way to what Kabbalists called the higher self. But the Tree of Life does not only speak of the origins of the physical universe out of the unimaginable, but also of man's place in the universe. Since man is invested with mind, consciousness in the Kabbalah is thought as the fruit of the physical world, through whom the original energy can experience and express itself as a finite entity. After the energy of creation has condensed in the matter, it is thought to reverse its course back up the tree until it is once again united with the true nature, Keter. Thus, the Kabbalists seek to know himself and the universe as an expression of God and to make the journey of returning by means of the stages charted in the spheres until he has come to the realization he sought. All right, I hope that makes some sense. That's the basics of it. Without getting into each individual one separately, that kind of gives you a general overall look at it. And really, if you want to dwell deeper into it, there's plenty of sites. Just look up Kabbalah, and it can be spelled with a K or a Q, and see what they have to say. It can get really complex and vary and everything from one to another. So that's what I'm talking about when I say it's on the tree of life. Between the spheres of this and that, it's to kind of give you a sense of what the card is all about and where it lies within people or in relationship to people. So I hope that made sense. And I'd never went too deep into it. I kind of know what it's about, but didn't do a whole lot of deep research into it. And so I'm no expert, but I'll give you the basics here. There's a lot more written on it, and y'all can take it from here. All right, so thanks for watching. You all take care. Bye-bye.